How many of you know who D.A. Pennybaker and Haskell Wexler are? Are there people that don't know? So this is a clip that involves those people and myself and Pennybaker is called Penny, his wife. We had all come back together after going off and shooting various projects. I'm trying to make a film about Haskell, who is 90 years old. He's a two-time Oscar winner, director of photography. He's a political activist. He makes documentaries. He directed a film called Medium Cool, which is the most amazing classic documentary. But he's got a foot in both worlds, you know, the Hollywood and the documentary world. And Penny is one of the fathers of cinema verite, and certainly, you know, my mentor. So we had all, I had gone out with Haskell. I was shooting him. He was running to be president of the Cameraman's Union and won. And Penny and Chris were in town doing something, trying to get a project off the ground. So why don't you roll the first clip? You know this great quote from Carl Rice, which is my favorite quote, which Haskell also now uses all the time, which is, cinema verite is wanting what you get, not getting what you want.
Yeah.
What's wrong with asking people to do something they do anyway all the time and shoot it because it's reality, but it's not.
But you're not really, I'm never trying to film reality. That never occurs to me.
What?
I'm trying to capture whatever people are doing. I'm trying to film what I see happening in front of me.
Absolutely.
And I don't know what reality is, really. I mean, it's just what happens in front of me is very real. And in the end, I use it any way I want. So I throw away all of the provincialisms of whether or not you say action or not. But when I'm shooting it, it's just what I see.
It's a process of discovery.
Yeah,
you know?
Of discovery, right.
And that's what I have. Especially with these little cameras now, because you're so much a participant.
Yeah.
You are there as a person, they can see your face and you can react. And so it's very experiential. And it's revolutionary, you know, to have access to that kind of equipment, where, you know, it's a journey, you know, that I'm going on. It's my trip, you know. It's what I'm hoping to do is to recreate for other people.
What
it is I'm discovering as I'm going through whatever it is I'm following.
You know, primitive people, a lot of people say that, don't take my picture, you're stealing.
Okay, you're stealing my
you're stealing,
soul.
You're stealing. In a sense,
that's right.
You're taking pictures, and when you're taking pictures, it gives you a control. Doesn't mean that you say, I'm going to control that guy and so forth, but there is a feeling of control. You can say, I only shoot what I'm interested in, but you're interested in things which, in a sense, you're taking.
I want to eventually control because I want to end it.
And also, the fear of the person on the other side is how that control will be used.
Protect his life.
Yeah. And even as Joan says, we are sort of purely, you know, well, I'll just stay back and whatever happens, and we just have to wait till it happens, you know.
I don't stay back, though. I'm right in the middle.
What do you say, Joan?
I'm in the circle. I'm participating. I don't hang back.
So
just like I'm participating right now.
You know,
I interrupted you because I had something to say.
Yes, but Joan, suppose you wanted to ultimately take what you shot here tonight and make it into a little film. Just
that's what I'm trying to do. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So they're controlling you. Now,
Joan, and then after you're cutting the film and so forth, you'll say to me, Haskell, who visited you, Haskell, do you still have that blue shirt that you wore?
See,
wait a second.
That.
Let me ask you a question. And because you feel that your thing that you shot, if you had a scene of me coming through that door, scratching my balls or something, you know, would you think that that would really give a profound meaning to this film that you shot 6 months before, you wouldn't ask me to do it?
Absolutely. Would not.
I would.
Never.
I would.
And it's an undertaking I give to anybody.
Because it's just another piece of artifice that you've done, just as you've decided what focal length to be on at this
but
very
moment.
But it's
irrelevant. It's irrelevant, ask. Because it wasn't part of the situation, it's irrelevant. I mean, I think the editing you do want to control, but I don't think you want to adorn.
But the situation is the film. If the situation ceases to be...
No, the situation is people sitting around a table.
Bullshit.
You don't think that's right?
Well, I don't think you think... I don't think that when it comes right down to it, I think you...
I if you remove these cameras, this discussion would not be different.
But that's not what Haskell's saying.
No, that's...
That is what you're saying?
I think that the character of the discussion now would not... have the, maybe the exact words would be, it wouldn't have the meter, it wouldn't have the, maybe the concentration, which a relaxed three or four of us, or how many, were just sitting here, more tired than we may be acting, like I started very early this morning. I know just because of your, of that it's more than just Penny looking at me, who Penny could look at me and say, yeah, well, Haskell's tired. He had a long day, so what the fuck? But her looking at me on a piece of tape 5 weeks from now does not take that into account. So therefore, I'm speaking to you in an animated, younger than 85-year-old manner because I don't want to be perceived as an old fucking cameraman. What's reality?
Well, there's something that I don't... You know, the way I solve the problem that you think I'm looking at this as movie maker, the way I solve the problem is I don't think at all. And that sounds... No, that sounds crazy, but when I get into the camera, I don't think. I'm like a cat watching a room full of people. I don't... And when people say, well, how do you decide... I don't decide anything. I'm in there floating in that camera, just watching what goes on. And I sometimes feel a little guilty that I don't take responsibility. It's like the painter who doesn't look at the canvas when he paints. But it has a lot of that. But I think that that's the way I protect myself from some aspect of what you're talking about, which is controlling.
Now, if you need a shot of me walking out to cut in for some other scene, that's fine.
Give me
an action.
Cue the walker.
Okay. Action. You might not have the right shirt on.
Adios, motherfucker. Thanks, Joan.
Good night.
Penny.
Good night.
It was great visiting with you.
Let's see.
To get to know you, Chris.
I can't believe we've shared so much of this.
Say hello to Rita.
I'm still so incredible.
One of the things I always say to people who are shooting documentaries is, don't cut when you think the scene is over, because that's when stuff will really start happening. Like Haskell came back in the door and gave Penny a hug, and you know, if I had cut, it would have changed the meaning of that that last moment. I wouldn't have gotten it. So anyway, I would like to make this really as interactive as anybody cares to. So if you have anything you want to say, raise your hand, and I'll see if I can deal with it. But
What was that? What were we watching? I mean, was it an idea to make it into a film about him?
That's one of, you know, hundreds of hours of footage I have on Haskell. And that was a three-hour, I spent 3 hours that night shooting. They hadn't really spent any real time together. They grew up in Chicago. They're two years difference in age. They grew up in the same part of town. They listened to the same radio shows. They followed the same, you know, baseball teams and played in the park, And so they were just like, wow, do you remember that? And it was just a sort of wonderful connection of these two people who are, you know, iconic.
That's amazing. And because obviously you were in the scene at the beginning, and then
right.
It felt
we both
like
had
you'd taken a
our
camera.
Cameras. You know, we both had brought our cameras in, and actually, I was telling Penny that the camera they were shooting with was crap, and they should have a look at mine. And you know, so she was Chris, Penny's wife, was just fooling around with a camera, and I doing some shooting as well.
And what did you think about what he was actually saying, which was that when people are filmed, they, no matter how natural you think they are, even in the intonation of their voice, they're presenting, like in, I'm speaking as a question and I'm speaking outwards, I'm performing it
right.
To a certain extent because I know that people can hear me. So the same way in any documentary, to a certain extent, people are performing.
Right. Well, what I try to do is to get beyond that so that you capture the essence of people. And it's a way of being that means you have to be totally there in the moment. You need to be involved. You need to be the kind of person that people want to have around. You need to be genuinely interested in people, and that all kind of shines through. And it's a question of sort of earning your place in that circle. I don't want to stand back and shoot over people's shoulders. I want to be part of that social circle. Mm. And what people, you know, generally people who agree to be in a documentary are doing it for a reason. They have something they want to get across. They have something they want to say, or they want to promote themselves, or you know, whatever. And so it's a really amazing experience to be able to cut out the social bullshit that you usually have to go through to get to know people. And you have these incredibly intense experiences sort of just off the bat. And it's something, you know, that you have to be respectful of. Because people do, very often, people do lay themselves out, you know, heart and soul. So, you know, it's a responsibility you have to treat that with respect.
I thought it was interesting what you said, that you are a participant when you're shooting. And the question I have is that if you imagine when you were shooting 30 years ago on a 60mm camera.
That's what I want to talk
for
about.
For example, okay, so yeah. I just want to talk, what I'm interested in is your relationship with your subjects. Has that changed due
totally.
To how you,
totally.
The kind of cameras that are out there now?
So I started in, you know, I went to UCLA Film School. The dean of that school was Colin Young, who then came here and started the National Film School, which is where I ended up living in England for 10 years, because I started there teaching, and then I hooked up with Nick Broomfield and blah, blah, blah. But when I started, the NPR Eclair had just kind of become available, and it was a revolution. You could suddenly put a camera on your shoulder. It was silent. You could have sync sound. And you could make entirely different kinds of films. So, you know, it was an amazing revolution. And Colin, the way he organized the school was pretty much the way the National Film School was in the early days, which is basically undergraduates and graduate students all took the same courses. It was very loosey-goosey. There was no structure, and you just had to be self-motivated. And but if you were, you could do anything. And it was very exciting. And for me, you know, it was 19, when I started, it was 1964. There weren't camera women. I had no role models. And it never occurred to me that I could shoot, you know, although I did shoot in school and took, you know, turns working on other people's projects because that's the way it was structured. And one of my teachers, James Blue, who's no longer with us, came and said, you know, you should shoot. You should do this. This is good. You have talent. You're good. And I, you know, I thought it was great, but I ended up starting as an editor when I got out of film school. And then I had a sort of series of really incredibly lucky breaks. I was an editor for a while, but I kept, you know, wanting to shoot, and the students that I'd gone to school with would get jobs, and they would hire me to shoot because they knew I could shoot. And so I was sort of had a foot in both camps for a while, and then I finally decided, okay, I've got to stop editing and just go for it. And I got a succession of jobs. The first one was I was asked to go and shoot a concert that Jimi Hendrix was putting on. And I was literally just right out of film school, and I hired all my friends, and we flew up to San Francisco because we were based in LA. And I was given just enough money to buy the film, rent the equipment, and hire like three camera guys and a sound guy. And we went up and we shot this film. And then that led to my getting hired to work on Gimme Shelter. And so I'm going to show three clips. They're very short, which, you know, are the sort of the very beginnings of my shooting career. Thank you.
I have to do now is get my posing routine out, down more perfect, which is almost impossible to do, you know. It's perfect already.
The story behind Gimme Shelter is I had been dropped in the night before a helicopter to shoot all the eager beavers who had campfires waiting to get in. And I didn't sleep or eat all night and couldn't get into, I wasn't let back in to go to sleep until they opened the gates. And so, you know, at 8 o'clock in the morning with the crush of the crowd, I came and I was told, you need to go to the other side and shoot the cars arriving. And so I was stumbling along. People were offering me food and drink, and which I took, and I got myself over to the other side of this vast place and held my light meter up, and there were rainbows shooting out of it. And I was like, oh no, I'm stoned. And somebody had given me some acid, and I just remember. It was really, 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 really bad trip. And I climbed under the stage and clung onto the legs of the guy who was camera right, who happened to be an old friend of mine. And you know, but every time I'd open my eyes, this is where all the violence was, and the Hell's Angels were bashing people, and everybody was trying to get up there. And I, you know, every time I looked, opened my eyes, I was just horrified. And then at 4, you know, 8 hours later, I was back, I was okay, and they put me at the back of the stage and gave me my own Hell's Angel as my guardian angel. And I became transfixed with this guy in the front of the stage who obviously was experiencing a similar trip to what I had just gone through. And so I probably shot, you know, an entire magazine on him. And you know, I didn't care. Who was prancing around in that red outfit, you know? I'm much more interested in the guy. But so Charlotte Zwerin, who edited that film, and with some help, I believe, from the head of Doc House, and she saw that shot, and she was the producer of a television series that was about to start up called An American Family, which was the real beginning of the first kind of reality television. It was all verité. It was 13 one-hour shows. It was about this family in Santa Barbara, and they had 5 kids, and you know, the husband and wife split up in the middle on camera, basically, and the eldest son comes out and announces he's gay, and everybody in America was watching this show. It's just, people were transfixed by it. And so, you know, I was just really lucky that because of these connections, I think I got more experience. I was there for 7 months, and I got more experience in those 7 months than most people would get in about 5 years. You know, we were shooting with eclairs. We had to be ready to go anywhere in the world at the drop of a hat. You know, I would be filming the husband talking to his girlfriend in his office. He said, okay, well, honey, I'll see you in the airport in 20 minutes. And we had to be ready. And this was with cameras, film, magazines. You know, you didn't travel lightly in those days. So we designed this sort of box that held everything, including a toothbrush and, you know, the changing bag and the film we might need, and you know, I mean, literally we would have to be ready to go. So it was very, very good training for me. But you'll notice that the way I was shooting, like I was shooting Jimi Hendrix's moccasin. So, you know, I had a different style then that I have now, which is, you know, I was doing very tight, what I thought were arty shots of details that, you know, forced the audience to look at what I wanted them to see. And then when I came here to England, people like Nick, I mean, Nick Broomfield was shooting his own films until we hooked up. And, you know, he would shoot just wide shots without any zooms and, you know, and I kind of evolved in terms of the way I shot so that, you know, I would shoot things in such a way that the audience could actually decide what to look at rather than my, you know, zooming in on somebody's shoe or fly on their nose or something. But, you know, and with the, both the Aton, you know, I graduated from an éclair to an Aton. I'm left-eyed. So, you know, I have a camera here, the lens here, the eyepiece would go to my left eye, and I couldn't see people, you know. There was no relating to people. I wasn't a human being. I was just a big glass eye to these people. So when these little small digital cameras came along, for me, it was just an amazing opportunity to completely change the way I make films, you know, which is to be interactive and to be a person to these people. I think it's just the most wonderful thing that you can use this equipment. You can put anything you need to make a film into a backpack, including the computer to edit it and go anywhere in the world and make a film. So that's really very, very exciting, you know, and it doesn't cost a lot of money. So people should go out and make their films. They don't have to wait for commissioning editors and blah, 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 you know. I think if you have a passion, and particularly, you know, I think if you have uncommon access, you have access to a particular subject that nobody else has, you're the person to make that film. So, any questions?
Have you taken acid since to enhance your film?
No!
Jokes aside, actually, do you think that on that day, even though you spent half the day under a table or something, that it actually may have added something to your sort of mind's focus at that moment, being on drugs?
Well, I don't remember, but... I mean, obviously, yes. Obviously, yes. I mean, I was there to shoot a Rolling Stones concert, and what I was doing was shooting the guy who was writhing around in the background.
That is an incredible scene.
It is.
Can I ask another question as well about the left eye thing?
Yeah.
Because I think I don't really understand what that means, but I've got a feeling.
Well, you
leave
with one eye
well.
Or another, and there is a test you can do that somebody else can administer, which I always do when I teach. When the first thing I do is I do this test, which is basically you have to take a ruler or, you know, some straight line, and it has to be farther away than the person's arm. You know, it has to be, you know, say, at least 4 feet away. And you get the person you're testing to, with both eyes open, line the ruler up to some vertical line behind, like a corner or the edge of the screen or something like that. And then you ask them to close one eye and close the other eye, and it will jump. It'll stay in one place with the eye that you lead with, and it'll jump with the eye that is your weak eye. And that's it. So the eye that you lead with, for me, is my left eye. You can't do it with your own
eye. You've got to be
farther away. You can't do it yourself. It has to be farther away. I promise you. And
you couldn't retrain to use the other side of your eye.
Well, I do now. I do now because I think my eyesight's changed, and because of the digital cameras. I Molly and I had a little giggle downstairs about, you know, she said, I know you're going to say that you always shoot with that flip out screen, and I so you know, different strokes for different folks. But I, you know, I love the flip out screen.
And she said the opposite. She said it distanced her.
Yeah, she likes to shoot with the eyepiece, and I find it does the same thing. It blocks me from the relationship I might have with people. So anyway,
I find that strange you saying that, because you shot, you know, for many years amazing things without. I mean, the flip out screen is 5 years old, 6 years old maybe.
Or ten.
It didn't stop you. It didn't stop. You know, I'm thinking of how you would shoot things 20 years ago, and I remember you saying in one of your talks that you, as a camera person, you are eyeballs. You are just eyeballs looking. Whereas if you have a flip-out screen, that is a very different relationship with your subject. You're not eyeballs. You're in that
you're
room.
You're part of that scene.
And I think it is very different.
I think.
But you're saying, oh, it's changed your life. I'm not. What I'm saying is, it was pretty good what you did before.
It changed the kind of interactions I could have with people while filming. Mm. And so I shoot films. I make my living with that craft. Every once in a while, I make a film myself, or with Nick, or you know, with somebody. I earn my living with a camera, and I will shoot. Of course, I will shoot what people want me to shoot. But most of the time, people hire me because they think of me as a verité camera person, and then they just get out of the way. You know, you can't really direct somebody who's in the minute, you know, moment shooting. You know, it's not like you can say to somebody, "Well, zoom now," because they don't know what I'm doing. You know, and so it's a question of just trust, I think. But as far as my own filmmaking, that's where I think it's such a great opportunity to be able to be freed from being just the glass eye. And I just value that relationship, and I think it's a kind of, you know, acknowledgement that there is a filmmaker there. There is a presence. You know, the verite filmmakers, we're all doing fly on the wall kind of thing. And, you know, on an American Family, where we spent 7 months with this family, I'm sure Pat Loud had decided to go ahead with asking for a divorce from her husband because she had this very sympathetic, supportive people in her life at that point who were there all the time. But you know, when we put the cameras down, we would talk. And then the minute the camera came up, they would all pretend like we weren't there. You know, and how phony is that? But that's what was going on. And that's, you know, the fly on the wall kind of approach. But I think it's much more honest to acknowledge that you're there. You're definitely a part of what's going on. I did my husband, Alan Barker, sound person and technician extraordinaire, and I spent a year in a hospital doing a film called The Residence, and I'm going to show that clip down the line. And, you know, we lived the life of residents. We kept their hours. We fell in love with the same patients. We were devastated when they died, and we were sharing the experience that these interns and residents were having, and we were just a part of that subculture. We became a part of the experience that we were all going through, and to this day, and actually I have to say, so many subjects that I've made films about or shot are still my really dear friends. I've been spending 10 days at Christmas with somebody I made a film about in 1989. You know, she's my dear friend. So, you know, it's a wonderful life, you know. It's great to be able to travel around the world and have these incredibly intense experiences with people and not be a tourist, you know, get let into people's lives. And if that's what you're interested in, that I'm only interested in people. I don't care about buildings. But unless anybody, does anybody have anything else?
Yeah. What's been the biggest challenge of your career so far?
I think working on the Aileen film, which Claire here cut. Being asked to be there for her execution, which was just devastating. Just the thought of trying to do that was just way too much. Well, I mean, that was certainly one of those moments when it was really, really difficult. But there, you know, every film, there are challenges in every film.
Can I ask one more question?
Yeah.
You know, you're talking about sort of the new camera, and it gives you this ability to interact with a flip-out screen. Do you think that you also, at the same time, lose that kind of incredible focus and being in the scene and the sense of composition and everything that you would have looking through a viewfinder?
I think it's very different. When I first took up shooting with the flip-out screen, you know, it was like, oh no, I'm not, I'm a little ski-whiff, or, you know, I'm looking up people's noses because it's really hard to hold a camera up like this, you know, for hours and hours. I don't know how Molly does it. And then I just, like, said, oh well, okay, it's a different thing. It is what it is. And forgot about caring about that kind of stuff. It just is different. And I accepted it on that premise. I mean, I try to raise the camera up to people's eye levels. But, you know, I do not want to wear a brace. I don't want to be tied to not being able to move, not being able to jump in and out of cars. I don't want to stop the action ever. You know, I don't want to ask people to do something because I need to take the brace off or put it on, or could you wait just a minute? I mean, I don't believe in interceding in their reality. And if I miss it, I miss it. That's too bad. But, you know, I don't even take tripods to most shoots with me. And, the way I function is I have a bum pack that I wear. It's stuffed full of everything I need for the day. The batteries, you know, it's the cards now. It used to be tapes. Lens cleaning stuff, you know, lipstick, aspirin, just everything you need. And I use it as my tripod. And, you know, it turns out that an awful lot of what you're doing, you're either following people walking, in which case, if you're walking with them, you don't really notice that the camera's going like that. But most of the time, you're filming people, like in the residence, there would be doctors standing up looking at people who are lying on gurneys, and I would be able to shoot up from this level up into the doctor's face, who was looking down at the person at the gurney, and then I'd be eye level with the person at the gurney, or people sitting around tables, or people sitting on seats. If you're standing, you know, and you've got the camera like this, you're eye level with people who are seated. And you can glide around and make those moves, you know, with the camera that's on your shoulder. You know, if you want to be eye level, you have to either kneel or you have to sit down, and then you have to get up and move. And since I'm always trying to flow and make everything work, it's just a joy to be able to do that. You know, you kind of cradle the camera a little bit when you're going to make a move, and, you know, a lot of them have steady shots, so it's just, it's a glide, and you make your move and carry on shooting. And that, I mean, that's something else that I want to talk about, which is, you know, I try to, once I start rolling, I try to shoot a scene so that it has a beginning, a middle, and an end. And then I stop. But I don't stop until I feel it's a whole piece. And when I'm shooting everything so that it works. I don't ever go like this to, you know, my camera and walk around to get another angle. You know, I would make it work. I'd go around shooting. It's all cuttable. It's all, and I know it will be cut by an editor, but I find looking at this stuff in real time, it's so fascinating. It's, for me, the best thing about shooting this stuff, you know. Is it the magic that I thought it was, you know? If you see it in real time, I just love getting sucked into this footage. And I'm always trying to shoot, you know, for content, not for beautiful shots. I'm not thinking about, to me, the composition and the lighting and all that stuff, I mean, it's great if it works out, but it's not what's important to me. What's important to me is getting the nub of the moment, getting that emotion that's happening, the heat of the moment, the interchange between two people, and being totally in sync with what is going on, so that I'm listening, really listening to what people are saying, so I understand where I need to be. You know, sometimes I'm not shooting the person that's speaking. I'm shooting the person that's listening because I'm interested in the reaction that that person is having, and I'm using the camera like my eyes. You know, whatever I'm interested in looking at is where the camera goes. And it's a completely organic thing. It's not intellectual. It's just trying to be there right in the moment and capturing the interaction that's happening in a way that captures it in real time and is, you know, understandable when people see it on the screen. And I know it'll be edited. And I'm always shooting so that it can be edited. But I don't do cutaways. I don't stop and take a picture of a clock. You know, I'll shoot something and I'll see the clock on the wall and I'll move up to it at the time when it's appropriate. And then I'll move back down, or maybe I'll widen out, depending, you know. And sometimes you get into a situation where you can't move because the emotion is so fraught that it's just better to stay in one place. And, you know, you have to be sensitive to that. And you know, if you move, you'll break that tension that's happening, or you'll create a stir, or, you know, it'll be a distraction. And so there are times when you just get stuck and you don't move for all sorts of reasons, but emotional moments are certainly one of them. So the other thing that happened to me that was really lucky is that when I was just getting out of film school, Peter Watkins came into town looking for somebody to shoot his film. And Colin Young, who was the head of the film school, suggested me. Do you know Peter Watkins' work? Anybody? Does anybody? Raise their hand if they do. Okay, so this is a film that was called Punishment Park. And Peter, it's a fiction film. But Peter shot the film as if it were a documentary. So he was looking for a documentary shooter. Maybe let's just look at the clip and then we'll, but these are people who are real people acting themselves.
Under the provisions of Title II of the 1950 Internal Security Act, also known as the McCarran Act, the President of the United States of America is still authorized, without further approval by Congress, to determine an event of insurrection within the United States and to declare the existence of an internal security emergency. The President is then authorized to apprehend and detain each person as to whom there is reasonable ground to believe probably will engage in certain future acts of sabotage. Persons apprehended shall be given a hearing without right of bail, without the necessity of evidence, and shall then be confined to places of detention. Time, 9 a.m. The Bear Mountain National Punishment Park in Southern California.
Right there, stop. You right behind him. Right there. You over there. Next man. Okay, that woman there, the last man in line. Okay, we're going into the tent.
Senator George McLewis resigned from the Senate today after 22 years of active service. He said in a press conference shortly after he walked from the Senate floor that he could no longer participate in what he called the dismantling of basic freedoms for which this country was established. He mentioned specifically the types of, quote, repressive, unquote, legislation which led to his sudden resignation. These included the no-knock laws, stop-and-frisk laws, cancellation of immunity for Fifth Amendment cases, preventative detention. He said that he was particularly disturbed by the reported activities in the punishment parks.
Marshal will now bring the 48th session of the tribunal to order. 48th Emergency Internal Security Tribunal of the Southwestern Region, as authorized by Executive Order Number 302, is now in session. William C. Holger, Chairman, presiding.
Will the court set bail? Some of these defendants have been in jail now for months without being sentenced.
We don't even know what we're arrested for.
Keep the defense quiet. Keep the defendants quiet. Bail denied.
Denied. That's all
the fuck
you can do.
We've been
in jail for 2 months, and we don't even know what we were arrested for.
Marshal, keep the defendants quiet. Leroy Brown, Jay Kaufman, James Arthur Kohler, Allison Michener, Charles Robbins, Nancy Smith, William Valerie. You stand here guilty of the grievous charge of conspiracy to undermine the national security and of separate charges which will be enumerated as so indicted and convicted at the preliminary hearings of the 5th Emergency Court of the 44th Precinct in the District of Glendale. Captain Edward Rubin, Sheriff's Department, presiding May 24th of this year.
Punishment Park, described by the U.S. Senate Subcommittee on Law and Order as a necessary training for the law officers and National Guard of the country in the control of those elements who seek the violent overthrow of the United States government and the means of providing a punitive deterrent for said subversive elements.
This trial is illegitimate and it will be exposed to everybody.
These are the members of Corrective Group 638. And these, the members of Corrective Group 637, now sentenced to spending 3 days in Punishment Park.
I was never around when Peter was working with the actors. And what he would do is he'd go off and work with them, and then he would bring them in and say, turn over, you know, and I would start rolling, and I didn't know what was going to happen. I had no idea. And I would shoot it at, you know, and after the first day of rushes, he said, well, you know, it's, could you sort of shoot it like you're a news crew and, you know, do some crash zooms and search for focus? I don't think you saw any of that on this clip, but, you know, and so in other words, you know, look like, just don't be so smooth. And then he also would come and sort of knock me every once in a while. I was just furious, you know. And so we'd do a take, and they'd be very long takes, literally, you know, entire magazines, like, which in America was 11 minutes at 24 frames per second. And then if we did another take, I'd say, aha, now I know what's going to happen. But he would change it up. He would have somebody else walk in, or there would be something to throw me off guard, just so I didn't know, I couldn't anticipate what was going to happen. And I just saw this film. We had a screening in Los Angeles a couple weeks ago, and it was incredible. It's so apropos of what the world is like right now. And I think, you know, because these people are playing themselves, it's like a documentary. And I remember when it was shown in Paris, Jean Rouch came out of the theater clucking and saying, you know, I didn't have any idea that things were so bad in America. he thought it was a documentary. You should see it if you haven't seen it. It's been re-released and remastered, and it's actually 4x3, not 16x9. But maybe they're all like that. I just sat down there. All the stuff on the demo reel is 4x3, I believe. But anyway, we're all used to seeing things in the wrong format. So that was a really controversial film, and people thought it was real, and it was a great experience for me, and I went on and shot another film for him. But those were the only two fiction films I've shot ever. People are always saying, "Are you interested in dramatic films?" And I say, "Well, I feel like I shoot dramatic films. I think they're very dramatic." But they're not make-believe. And I think, you know, the kind of films that I am interested in doing are you know, they're dramatic narratives. There's certain subjects that these kinds of observational films can't deal with. They can't be about things in the past. They're not polemic films. They're just experiential films. And you have to find the characters who can carry that. You know, they have to be people that the camera loves and that, you know, are articulate and somehow mesmerizing. But, you know, they don't have to be famous people. They can just be ordinary people. But they have to have this something that makes an audience want to look at them. So, you know, when you're looking for films to make, you should cast your characters. Now, let me ask you, how many of you want to make films, or how many of you are cinematographers and want to make films?
I
think
this question
I'm answering. How many of you want to make films? Okay. How many of you are shooting films now? How many of you want to shoot films? You're all at the back. Okay. So let's see here. Is anybody comments or questions? Yeah.
You were talking about how you've moved from a way of shooting where you're making individual shots, you're showing people what to look at, to what you're doing now. Is that a reaction to having been an editor early on? Do you know what I mean? Because as an editor, you want someone to bring you stuff that you can cut.
Right.
Well, whereas a floating style is, I mean, harder to edit sometimes.
Well, which reminds me, there's something also I think everybody who wants to shoot should edit their own material, and that is the best way to learn, you know, how to shoot, and really you should do it. I've got a bunch of clips that I'm about to show that is basically unedited material, and they're either from films that haven't been finished, or when I was shooting in that moment, I was electrified by it, so I went and cloned it before I had to turn the footage over. And, in order to talk about shooting styles. But I do always shoot so that an editor, and I know an editor will edit the material. I mean, I'm going to show a 7-minute clip of somebody in a recording studio singing who kind of fell asleep at the wheel and started daydreaming and then kind of came back. And it's 7 minutes. I know it's not going to be used. It's going to be condensed. But to me, it was just this sort of magical moment. And then when it gets edited, it changes the experience. Sometimes it's great, and sometimes but it's always different. It's always different. But you have to edit, you have to edit material, so you better shoot it so it's editable. Yeah.
Is there? Can you think back to a time where you've made such a big mistake in the way you've filmed something that you, one, really learned something from it, but also so that so it couldn't be used? Was there anything that you...
Yeah.
Do you know what I
mean? I made a really big mistake once. I got hired by a German television outfit to go to the Marshall Islands to shoot for a couple of days, which the Marshall Islands had been a test site for the nuclear, for the U.S. dropping bombs, and they didn't. You know, they didn't have money to bring anybody else, so I was completely on my own. And I was looking at the material at night, and it seemed fine to me. But they, when they got it back to Germany, said to me that the color balance was all off, that it was actually, I hadn't color balanced. And it was all blue. And, they couldn't use it.
Yeah.
It could not be corrected. So that was a terrible mistake. So I'm really on to color balance. All you need to do is make that mistake once, and you'll never make it again.
But
there are times when, like in shooting, when you just get out of sync with what's happening, like you've got two people talking and you're always on the wrong person, you want to be on this person, and the amateur, the person who doesn't have a lot of experience, will kind of panic and do that and then get back to, and it makes it completely uncuttable. Whereas if you go to the person and you realize, that's the wrong move, but at least you stay there for a beat, and then you move back to the person you want to be on, and get back into to sync with the conversation, then it's usable, and it's cuttable. So things like that, when you think you've done the wrong thing, don't panic. Just let it stay there for a beat, and then correct it, It's,
Do you edit any of your own stuff now, every now and again,
to
sort of refresh that?
So I'm editing the Haskell stuff. Sort of. Long takes. yes, anything else? So this is a film I made for HBO. It's called Asylum. And I'll just roll the scene and then we'll talk about it.
You don't know who I am, and I'm going to show you. You guys, I'm the most racist. Hi, Hitler, come down here. Tell him, hi, Hitler, who I am.
There you go.
Tell him who I am. Tell Lionel Richie who I am. They all know me. This time, they're not coming back.
Yes. I need one moment here. Please, I need
And you told me they wouldn't. Yes, Mother. I love you. Yes, Mother. I need you. Yes, and your pick on Earthling! Oh, you guys really think you got new corners. Mastermind Criminal 2.3456, Daddy. Remember him? I'm the torturer. I'm the torturer. Every time you touch me, it gets worse.
Woo-wee. This is Patton State
Lyle
Hospital
Ritchie
here.
No longer exists. Your puller no longer and, exists. Your mastermind no longer
we
exists.
We have to treat you.
You're not shooting me up for nothing, buddy.
You want to take it easy, though.
There it goes! No, I don't take it easy because that means you can hurt me.
We're going to give you a shot of a medication called Ativan.
It's not
a mild tranquilizer.
Yeah, that's what you think.
And it has no effect
on pregnant
women.
You know what that means? Code 669-432,
it's
Daddy.
Related to Valium.
Are you going to let
and
them do it?
And it will
because
relieve this
do,
severe agitation
again,
that you're
I'll let
feeling.
Everything get destroyed.
And we want to
Believe
protect
me.
You from yourself.
If you keep letting
and
them
other
abuse me, and
you.
I'm being abused every second.
And then we're going to
oh,
have
yes,
you go
can.
Out into a quiet room.
Is
where
here.
You can have chance
Boom.
To
and
regain control
right
of yourself.
Boom, and we're in serfdom now.
And in the meantime,
serfdom.
We're going to be reviewing your
serfdom
legal
upon
records
serfdom,
to see
so
what
I'm
we
serfdom.
Can do to help you more.
Then.
So that was a scene from a film about a hospital for the criminally insane. And Catherine, that's Catherine Hernandez, came in. And it's one of the, there's a, about five characters that we follow in the film. And she's one of them. This is her when she's being admitted. And then, you know, later on she's calm and invites us into her room and talks about, you know, she's manic, she's bipolar. So she's talks about the experience is when she is in the manic phase, but you know, it's like Shakespeare. I mean, this is, I think, you know, what she was saying was just incredible. And so did Diana Ross, because my husband was working on a TV movie where she was the star and she was playing a homeless person. And she's walking down the street and she's, out comes this dialogue, verbatim. And Alan's like, what just a minute, you know, and went and talked to the person who was shooting it, who was Robert Leacock, Ricky's son, and said, that's been taken from my wife's film. And anyway, she had an earwig and somebody in a trailer, you know, down the street who was feeding her the line, and she was spouting it out. You know, it was really. And Alan was then fired the next day, but you know, it's part of the film. But so that's, you know, reality is sometimes much greater than fiction could ever pretend to be. But you know, when I was shooting that, you know, things like taking a risk, so that you, like I zoomed in on the shackles being put on, and you know, just being brave enough to take those risks. Sometimes they don't work, but sometimes they pan out, and they're just. Tremendous moments, you know, where you just are, you're lucky. And it's all just, it is luck, you know, but I encourage you all to try to take those risks and don't, you know, go with whatever you think, you know, would make that scene more interesting at that moment. And yeah.
You talked about when you're filming, you participate. Or you want to be part of that circle. When you're in a situation like that, where there's somebody who, in a way, is not themselves, you might be part of a circle with the people around her, but not with her.
Right.
And I wonder
how you deal with that.
Right. It's difficult. It's tough. I just last 2 weeks ago spent a week in a psych ER at LA County Hospital, and we were right at Halloween, which is October 31st, and we were shooting people who were coming in who were really, you know, they were homeless. They stopped taking their medication, and they were in extremis, and they were, you know, hurting. And I was not part of that circle. I mean, yes, I was part of the staff. I was following the doctors and the nurses, but I was not. And in fact, I was hanging back because I was told I needed to. You know, and I was also told here that we spent a month at this place, Patton State Hospital, and we were told that we would be attacked. And that we should never leave, you know, a screwdriver around or a light unattended or anything, and but we weren't.
Is there a point where you felt, I really don't think I should be filming this, or have you ever felt at that?
Of course,
point,
yeah, many times, yeah.
Have you ever put the camera down?
Yes, and I have not shot things, and I think that what you have to ask yourself is, what if you can live with the relationship that you've established with that person, if that person, you know, if for some reason you are respectful, if you feel that you are respectful of that person and that person's reality, and that by showing something that maybe shows them in a terrible state or in a bad light, that by the showing of it, you can make a difference in the world, then I think you can live with yourself.
Has there ever been a time when you've shot something and then not been happy with the way it's been used or edited? Or the outcome?
Well, I'll tell you, for instance, with the residents, here's a good example. I was a producer on that, and I was, you know, my husband and I and a third person who was basically getting the releases and kind of taking notes. So we were a three-person team. We said to people, look, if you say something in the moment that you don't want something used, we'll erase it. We can do that now. Once it gets to the production, we won't have any control over it. And we case in point, one of these, the woman that you're going to see, one of our favorite doctors, her name was Sunny, herself became ill and had a seizure while she was showing her grandparents around Hollywood Boulevard. And she was picked up by an ambulance, taken to another hospital. They thought she was a crack addict. And they just let her seize. And we hadn't been with her when it happened. And we went with her boyfriend to the hospital. I snuck a little teeny camera in. And I shot her seize in extremis, you know, having her seizure, which went on for 7 hours. And they finally knocked her out with a horse tranquilizer. And then she went into a coma for a couple of weeks. And everybody wrote her off. You know, when she did come back, she came back as a 3-year-old, really. She was like, Mommy, you know. And I happened to be there for that moment, and that was one of the most heartbreaking and beautiful moments I've ever been around for. But I gave her the tape of her in her seizure, and I said, this is yours. She wanted to see it, too. I told her, you know, we'd shot it. And she wanted to see it because she was a doctor. She did come back, and she ended up being the chief resident and very successful. You know, she's back doing what she wanted to do in San Diego, and she's fine. And she never had another seizure. But but it was really touch and go. But anyway, so we gave her the tape, and we said, this is yours. If you want to give it to the production, fine. You know, it's your decision. And I think, you know, a lot of times if you do that with your subjects, you give them, you let them feel that they they have some sort of control, they will trust you, especially if you actually, when they say, I want you to give me that tape, I want to keep it for a while, and you give it to them, then the next time they say, well, I'm going to go in here and I have this conversation, it's private, I don't want you to come in, you can say, well, let us film it, so at least we have it. You can have control of that, and later on, you can decide whether you want to give it to the production or not. And, you know, what happens is people have the sense of something. They're worried about being filmed at that moment. And then later on, much later on, 6 months later, when the film is being edited, that particular moment doesn't have the same heat on it. And people don't care. So they're, you know, they're happy to turn it over. So I think, you know, that's another way that you can kind of earn people's trust, where you let them feel that you're going to respect their wishes. And I think it's a good way to operate. You can't always do that.
How did you manage the releases for the Asylum one? I'm just wondering, because it's so raw, if there was anyone that you filmed who came in insane and remained insane.
And the same with this Psyche R thing. You have to wait until they're competent to sign. And you have to get a psychiatrist to sign as well. So, you have to be around long enough. There are very, very, very strict laws now. We couldn't have made residents now, because the laws have changed about, you know, shooting people without their consent. So, this is the last film I shot on film. This is Biggie and Tupac with Nick Broomfield. And, I just think this is a wonderful moment.
So did you see the FBI?
Yeah, I saw them. And after the Biggie death, you know, I had spoke to a couple of police, and I saw a couple of pictures that they had when they was watching us. They were showing me pictures of me, asking me who is that? And I'm telling them that's me.
I called the FBI agent who took the photos.
Your number was one of the numbers I was given. As somebody, you know, who was actually following Biggie at the time that he was shot, and who might be able to give me some information.
Okay, but who gave you my number?
You know, I just, sorry?
Who gave you my number?
I really don't know offhand who that was.
Okay, well, when you figure it out, beat me. I'll call you back and we'll talk.
Okay.
If FBI was following my son, where were they that night my son was shot?
In the meantime, Valletta put us in touch with Biggie's bodyguard. Valletta said he had a strange encounter when he was standing with Puffy just before Biggie got shot.
He was knocking like you were scared, man.
Scared?
Yeah.
No, I'm not there.
All right.
How do you do?
I'm good.
Gene's apartment had a great view. I asked him why his blinds were normally down and not open.
Black people don't do that. They go on a clear. I want you to see. I want you to be running out the door with your television. Yo, they got a TV and it's color.
I showed Gene the police composites of the hitman.
So do you recognize any of these pictures here?
This is the individual
that one.
This one right here.
That one.
Yeah, that's the one Lucy's did for the police. That's him right there.
That's him? Yeah. That's him.
That's the guy that came up to me.
That guy.
Wait, do
it again. That guy right there.
That's him.
Yeah.
Were you ever shown his picture before? That's definitely him, though.
Yep.
Well, that's Harry Billups, isn't it?
That's who?
He's called Harry Billups, Amir Mohammed, right? That's his name. That was the guy. You can really remember a face that well, wow.
You'd be surprised why. I can remember face.
You can't?
Yeah.
Yeah. I believe you, actually.
Mm-hmm. Hi, Russell.
We went to play Gene's interview to Russell.
How's it going,
John?
Hi.
That's the guy that came up to me. That guy.
Okay, so we got a witness saying David Mack was there, and now we got a witness saying Harry Billups
was
there.
That's definitely him,
though. Amir Muhammad, a.k.a. Amir Muhammad.
Yep.
It's amazing.
The rest of it. What do you make of that?
I think it's a breakthrough in the case. And the department, time and time again, has avoided the truth. And when you add everything up, what other reason could there be? The reason being is because they do not want to expose to the public that Los Angeles police officers were involved in the conspiracy to kill Biggie Smalls.
The only time I ever used a light on a Nick Broomfield film was that very first shot of the guy who's talking about how the FBI had taken his picture, this guy in red. And because I was too busy setting the light up for the interview, I missed, I wasn't even aware it was happening, but I missed, when he walked into the room, he went over and Violetta, Biggie's mother, had a little shrine on the sideboard with a little box with his ashes, and he went over there and basically did a little acknowledgement to this shrine, and I completely missed it, you know. And Nick was just like seething. But so that anyway, yeah.
I've worked with people who would probably ask him to do it again. Would you ever consider doing that?
No, never. And you know that's why I don't like lighting. I don't like making people feel that they're in a movie. And that they are actors, you know. It's the same reason I don't like interviewing people, because you put people behind a desk, there's a flower pot and a flag, and you ask them questions, and they become very presentational. They're presenting the image that they want your camera to capture. And, you know, it's why Nick will start the interview the minute the person walks in through or opens the door. And basically, he's like catching them off guard. You know, we sort of might get to the kitchen counter where they think they're going to give us coffee. We're going to set up and put the tripod on, and then they'll sit down behind the desk or in the chair and start the interview. But the interview is on the minute that person opens the door. And I think you capture much more a sense of that person by doing that. It's much more honest. You get much more of a sense of who that person really is. So yeah, for all those reasons, I eschew, you know, the lighting, the tripod, the setup, the asking, oh, sorry, would you walk through the door again? I wasn't ready. You know, all of that stuff. And I wouldn't be in front of them if they were going to walk in a door anyway. I would be following them. They lead. I follow. You know, you aren't. If you're in front of them, it means you know what's happening next. Well, you shouldn't know what's happening next unless you're manufacturing the reality. So for all those reasons, I'm not interested in doing any of that stuff. I don't walk in front of people, I walk behind them. They take me where they want to go. Yeah.
The last scene in that film, which it's been a while since I saw it, but you weren't available to shoot, were you?
You mean because of the prison?
Yeah.
I was available, but I was the only person who came from California. Everybody else had British passports. And when you go to that prison, they take your license or your passport and they hold it there. And I had a friend who worked at that prison, and I knew that Suge Knight ran that prison. He had a white limousine come up every day with caviar and cigars, and he ran the place. So I didn't want him to have my address. And, you know, Nick hightailed it out of Los Angeles when he was finished with that film, and he literally did not go back except for flash visits until right now. He's shooting another film there now. But for years and years, he moved back to England and stayed away.
Because of that film?
Yeah, because of Suge Knight. Because the obvious conclusion when you see the film is that he was responsible for their murders. And so now this is the clip residence. This is our favorite Dr. Sonny. And there's just a great reveal in this film. And this was shot with a little camera, and I'll talk about that afterwards, when I made the changeover.
Nice
to see you again.
Erickson.
God,
and I got a message from your pharmacy about the Wellbutrin.
Okay.
I recall. They are giving me trouble, and I'm trying to get it authorized.
Okay.
Yeah, have you quit smoking? How are your lungs?
Oh, my lungs. What are
you're
you
coughing.
Doing?
Oh, I know. Oh, my goodness.
What the hell are you doing?
Bedroom one. We have bed in the middle, right?
Yeah.
And how about the guys up front?
Yeah.
It's, guys like 50 or so. His wife hit him in the head with a bottle of vodka. It didn't break.
Just playing, or?
He's an alcoholic and went back to drinking.
So it's assault, was they file a police report?
Yeah, it's
domestic violence.
Really?
Women can beat up men, too.
So I have to file?
Mm-hmm. So you have to notify the police.
I'll tell him after I'm done. Is that okay? Guess I think he's drunk.
Okay, none of you.
So what we're going to do first is numb it up a little bit.
How are you going to do that?
Just like the dentist does. You know how the dentist
does it? You're going to stick a needle in my head?
Yep.
Oh, shit.
I know. Are you thinking that after this big incident of the head injury that you want to go back to AA?
Yes, I do. My wife. God, I got you and my mother.
And your wife.
Jesus.
We're all rooting for you.
And how the hell are you?
There's a dog here to visit you.
And
what do
you
think of that?
What the fuck is this?
It's a hospital dog.
She's here to visit you.
Oh, really? That's good. What if I had to like dogs? What would you do then?
I'd go away.
Oh, okay. You're lucky.
That's a dog. I'm so handsome.
What's the dog's name?
Oh. His name is Colia.
Okay. You can sit up. I'm just going to clean you up a little.
You know, I have to tell you something. No?
Here, I'll come over this way.
All right. Actually, you're pretty cute.
Why, thank you.
You're welcome.
You're not too bad either.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Are you getting all this on tape?
I hope so.
Well, I should hope so.
I have to tell you something.
I'd like the tape.
Let me tell you something, because I got your cut is all fixed up. It looks good, and it's going to... It looks like it's going to heal really well, and I'll take the staples out over in Les Kelly in like 10
days. It's the first one you did, huh?
No, it's not the first one I did. In like 10 days or so. Are you guys here for him?
Somebody called.
Oh, okay.
For what?
Let me just tell you something. I don't want to scare you, that any time, can I tell you something?
You say it to me.
Let me just tell you something. I didn't call him, but somebody else might, because anytime a husband or wife hurts the other one, whether it's a man hurting the woman or the woman hurting the man, and anybody finds out about it, then the police have to come and at least talk to the person.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because that's called domestic violence, whether it's the man or the woman. If there's a married couple or, you know, people who are together and one hurts the other, then they have to come talk to you.
Well, I'm sure my wife's out in the waiting room.
Okay. So they probably just, is that why you're here? You just want
to... Yeah, we need to speak to him.
Okay. I'm just about done.
Are you going to be cooperative with us, sir?
I'm not doing shit with you.
Okay,
well, you just keep in touch with us at home.
As far as I'm concerned, you guys can go. I don't know what you want to do with me.
I know, but it's the law is taking it out of your hands. That's
fine. You do what you want to do.
Okay.
Okay?
Are you going to tell us what happened?
I ain't telling you nothing. Why don't you go arrest the jaywalker?
We just came from that. We already taken one.
Good. I hope you're happy.
Sometimes, you know, serendipity, these things. I mean, I couldn't believe it when the dog showed up. Doc. Anyway, he was one of our favorite characters. He was very funny. And he became a friend, too. And he was just drunk, you know, having a good time. So we got to run along here, but anyway, I just love that moment when you see that the police are there, and I mean, this is unmixed. This is one of those things that I cloned because I just thought it was one of those really great moments, and so it's not. I don't think you really hear when the she goes and says that the wife. He started drinking, you know, he fell off the wagon, he was in AA, he started drinking again, so she got so mad, she hit him over the head with a vodka bottle, and then he said, that's domestic violence, you have to report it. But anyway, if it had been mixed, you might have understood that. But anyway, just the fact that the cops showed up, and he doesn't really understand that, you know. It's this wonderful sort of gift you give to the audience that they know something's going to happen before it happens to the guy. This is an example. It's a fairly short clip. Do you know who Arianna Huffington is? She has something posed. She ran for governor against Arnold, and Arnold won. But I was making a film about her. Alan and I were making a film about her campaign. And this is just a sort of a moment where it's kind of an example of, you know, not doing a formal interview, but sort of just kind of jumping in and, you know, making a comment and getting people to talk to you. So it's just a different way of getting information out of people without being formal about it.
Well, any contribution you can make, that'll be fantastic. Now the limit is 21,200. And also any people you can, who want to support the campaign that you can encourage to make a contribution, either by check or they can go to the website, which is arianaforgov.com, and they can contribute there.
The lines from the press release, so if you want, I can...
Okay, you can read them to me.
Okay, the public deserves more than sound bites. Which is a great soundbite. Now that the dust has settled on the circus aspect of the recall, it's time to begin debating serious issues facing the people of California. I'm challenging all the serious contenders to weekly substantive debates. People have had enough of politicians being controlled by their handlers. I'm ready to debate anytime, anywhere, and in any form. I'm looking for a free, robust, and unscripted exchange of ideas. The people of California deserve it.
That's it. Back here. Mm-hmm. It's going to look as though campaigns are about makeup. How understand.
Well, it's
women
different when you're
I
a woman.
The women can't spend in makeup.
It's definitely one of those things where it's easier to be a man in this world.
I think the campaign is about driving.
About driving, yeah.
You guys have you left LA yet?
The important tomorrow.
Oh, God.
The important thing is not to. Is how you use your time. Is multitasking, right?
Absolutely.
Have you ever sat here being made up without doing anything?
Never. She's constantly on her phone.
Even when the lipstick is being applied,
how she knows
talking.
Who she's talking to, I have no idea. But it's always darling, I love you, bye.
We're very impressed with your multitasking abilities.
But my mother, you know what my mother said? It was amazing. She would have loved you. The only time she got angry with me in the last year of her life was when I was talking to my children and opening my mail at the same time, and she said, "You can't do that. I hate multitasking," she said.
Really?
And I wrote a column about the joys of single-tasking.
Yeah, that was a film that never got finished because she changed campaign managers, and the second campaign manager shut us out. A lot of unfinished films in my career. But they're all great experiences. Just in the interest of moving on, unless anybody wants to ask a question or make a statement. This is that clip I was talking about with the Dixie Chicks. We were dealing with the producer, Rick Rubin, who's this giant sort of Buddha of a guy who did not want to be filmed. And so he would go into the recording studio and turn all the lights off. And, you know, so it was like, we wanted to film him. I mean, he was contributing a lot. There was a lot of interaction between him and the Dixie Chicks, and they were making an album, and he's a very well-known character, and just, you know, interesting person. So I ended up having to kind of sneak into the room and get somebody else to kind of notch the light up a little bit, you know. And then I would kind of shoot from behind him so that he wouldn't really, he would figure it out after a while, you know. And then he was just too gracious to, as long as I just wasn't in his face, I could shoot, you know, and be allowed to stay in the room. But, you know, sometimes we were shooting in, and yeah, that was the other thing, you know, we were shooting in the studio, and my God, I mean, if you banged into a microphone, you'd be out of there. So, and the room was littered with mics, and every, you know, music stands and instruments, and it's just, you know, it was all very dim. So we brought in a bunch of little kind of Christmas lights and just put them all over the walls. And then we used these big Chinese lanterns or Japanese lanterns, and we put them on the booms. You know, recording studios have these big mic booms that you can move around, and they're very heavy. And you'll see that in the shot too. It's just, you know, some way of lighting the subject because musicians like to work in the dark. But so this is a scene where I'm in a tiny room. There's three Dixie Chicks. I'm in the corner where I have a kind of a good shot of Natalie Maines, who's the main singer, and you'll see. But I could not move from that spot, and I had Natalie, another singer here, and the third chick here behind me. And Alan, who's doing sound, was right in the middle of the room. It was the only place he could be. And so I would have to do all these whip pans. If you look, you'll see him, that he's there, but I don't think most people notice it. And anyway, this is something I just shot. And of course it's going to be edited. It's never going to be used at this length. It's long, but it's a kind of a magical moment.
There,
it sounds
can you
like
wait
a thing.
To come
sounds
in?
Really
when you come
good.
In from the top, it just sounds like Kid Rock to me. I mean, not Kid Rock.
Who are you talking about?
No, I mean, No, Kid Rock. I didn't mean Kid Rock. I thought I said Chris Rock. No, it sounds like, I don't know. It sounds like Kid Rock to me.
Who?
The lick my dad plays to come in. Oh. I don't know. That's...
Kid Rock.
Kid Rock.
Okay.
Kid Rock.
How can
we get it to be more James Taylor and Kid Rock? That's what I'm trying to figure out.
I love that. I mean, to me, that's what makes
Dave
it.
Matthew sprinkled
from the top.
Southern.
It's Camaro Rock.
Camaro.
Where's my Camaro? Get my
does
Camaro.
Sound like you need a Camaro.
It?
Where's my El Camino? Okay, guys, we're going to play it one more time. Remember everything that was good about the last one, and this time give it a little bit of a Steve Miller essence.
Okay, yeah! One question I've got to ask.
Yes.
That time, Natalie, did you sing two choruses at the end before we started in the instrumental thing?
No. Not this time or the time before.
You didn't?
No.
So then after the breakdown verse, you do one more verse, then just one chorus?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Nope.
Shall we?
Yeah.
Here we go. One, two, ready.
All the people under broken homes don't want to fight no more. All the people nursing shattered bones don't want to fight no more. But there's no profit in peace, so we gotta fight some more. And all those who are in foreign lands don't wanna fight no more. And all those who lost their feet or hands don't wanna fight no more. But there's no profit in peace, boys, we gotta fight some more. Hey, we don't wanna fight. No more. Hey, yeah. We don't wanna fight no more. There's no problem in peace, boys. We gotta fight some more. And all of us just trying to play their part. They wanna fight no more. And all those who want a human heart don't wanna fight no more. But there's no peace.
Bye.
totally daydreaming. How long did y'all play that before I came in?
That was beautiful. We're going to take a 5-minute break and clear our heads.
Well, one question. At the end, we said two choruses, but that's not a chorus. That's a repeat.
Yeah. Okay.
Something that could help the monotony is, you know, on the Ocean Colour Scene song, there's a guitar that's going dun 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 dun
dun dun dun dun dun dun.
That could be over the chord.
Whoa! I turned totally off and I'm grieving my
Can you say don't worry? This is what I used to play in the band.
I know, but...
Hey, Dad, I don't want to get away with that.
What?
We were trying to do
that. No, I know.
That's an example of, you know, finding characters that the camera loves. I could look at Natalie Maines, even if she's falling asleep in the microphone, forever. You know? I just think it's kind of... Does anybody else feel that way, or?
Yep.
She's a, you know, you've got to cast your characters, find those people. One of the things that happens when you're making films in recording studios or about the recording of an album is you never know which is the take that they're going to use. So you have to film absolutely every take as if it was the first time you've ever done it in your life with exactly the same enthusiasm that you've, even if you've done it 10 or 20 times, because that could be the take that they decide to put in the album, and if you haven't filmed it, you haven't done your job. So, you know, you have to have the same stamina they do. They, you know, maybe take 20 before they get it right, too. So, that's what we were doing for weeks.
After, I think, the clip in The Residence, you were going to talk a little bit about camera use.
Oh, that's right, yes. Okay, so we started out with that, in Residence, with shoulder-mounted cameras. And we were having a tough time because, first of all, we were new to that culture. The production had a 20-page release they were asking everybody to sign, and the doctors, of course, read the release, and they were like, hey, you know, we're not signing this. There's a lot of tension, and plus there was this great galumping camera that was getting in the way of everything, and we were shooting, for instance, with one night in the ER, and a motorcycle accident victim came in. He had been on his bike, and he was not going to make it, but they were using him as, you know, a teaching cadaver, basically. I mean, and they rushed him in on a gurney. It was a tiny room. They brought in all sorts of stuff, and they were, you know, poking holes in him, and blood was all over the floor, and he was slipping around, and people were running in, and fortunately, and I had. We had these small cameras, and fortunately I was using the small camera in that situation. It was just happenstance that I happened to have that one instead of the big one. And, you know, I was able to get out of people's way. This was, you know, an extreme situation, serious trauma. The resident that we were filming had lost her brother in a motorcycle accident. We knew that too, and it was very, you know, highly emotionally charged for her. And she was the person we were focusing on. And, you know, thank God I had that camera because I could get out of the way and I could also use it. You know, I could get through the armpit of the doctor and see the blood that was being given and, you know, just hold the camera up and look down. You know, if I just had the camera on my shoulder, I would have been way too clumsy to get the scene, and I would have really annoyed people, and you know, I wouldn't have been welcomed, you know. And so I show the scene to the executives and said, look, you know, I don't want to shoot this film with a big camera. I want to shoot it with a small camera, and they let me. And there were two other crews shooting in another hospital. We were following the family practice doctors, and they were filming the surgeons. And I think it's some of the best footage I've ever shot in that show. And I think it's because of the camera. And I don't think it was possible to shoot and shoot that intimately and be able to finesse your way in those situations unless you had that small camera. So that's what I was going to say about that.
When you're in a situation, do you think to yourself, right, this is the beginning? Do you think about how that scene is going to be edited together and follow it until you think, right, that's the middle, that's the end, I've got that scene covered?
Yeah, absolutely.
Intuitively.
Which means even though there's a lot of waiting around in a documentary, you have to be engaged. You have to be aware of what's happening all the time. And hopefully the person you're working with, and hopefully you're just two people. You know, the smaller the better, I say. And the filmmakers should be the crew, ideally. And that everybody is in sync with what's happening. They're just, even though they've been sitting there for 2 hours waiting for something to happen, they haven't gone to sleep. And they haven't started fiddling with their iPhone or reading something. I mean, they're just there and wired, so they know what's happening and they're in tune. And then and when you work with your family, hopefully you have a group of people that you like to work with, and you figure out how to work together. Then you do that over and over and over with the same people. And they're, we don't have to tap the other person on the shoulder and say, let's roll, you know. It's just know. It's time. This is something that's happening now that's important to get. And, it's a question of being engaged and being observant. I'm sorry.
Okay, everybody. I'm terribly sorry too. I wish we could go on. You did say only 2 hours. Anyway, but I hope it's been a useful day for everyone. And most of all, I'd like to say thank you very much, Joan. Brilliant.